very distinguished speakers and invited guests. It's a great honor and privilege for me to be here amongst this distinguished gathering to speak about national security. Now, what I will be speaking is somewhat different than you have heard from most of the speakers. Let me tell you some background before I go on the topic. The national security is threatened by a variety of factors. It could be organized crime, it could be internal destabilization, it could be civil disobedience, it could be terrorism, it could be militancy, it could be kidnappings, it could be drug trade, arms trade. There could be many other manifestations of threat to national security. It could be coup d'etat, as His Excellency Mr. Dukaran mentioned. Now, all these threats are manifestation of something, which I'll come back. We have response to these threats, which are provided in various forms. It would be more policing, more armed forces, better equipment, better arms, more intelligence, satellite, intelligence, all kinds of technological devices used. So these are the crimes and these are the responses which we are using. Now this is a chase. We must know why these crimes are happening, because everything which origins in this world originates from human mind. If there is a crime, if there was an attack on 9/11, it was originating in somebody's mind how to do it. They planned it and they execute it. So the criminals have their mind is fertile, and they are actually giving you a lead, and the state is chasing them to find means to control them. So this chase is continuing chase. It has been going on in the entire history, and this is not going to stop. In fact, the more sophistication comes, the more sophisticated crimes will also come. So how do we reach that? Another point I want to mention here is that it's not a regional or national threat anymore. It has become globalized. There are no boundaries anymore. The cyberspace has abolished all the boundaries which we had. So don't think about your country, don't think about region, think about the humanity as a whole. Now how do we tackle that issue? We have to tackle the basic problem, what is the human mind. In UNESCO's constitution, it has been said that all the wars originate in the minds of the men, and if we want to tackle them, we have to tackle them there. And that is why I have chosen this subject, spirituality and religions. There are two aspects through which we can tackle human mind. One is value education, another is religion. And these are the ones which direct human mind in the right way. Now, I will briefly speak about the religion and their role, because today religion has actually become a source of conflict. In fact, a large number of terrorist activities are performed in the name of religion. And therefore, it has acquired a very special significance and we must tackle it. Now, what is religion? Just to give a few background, that curiosity is innate in the human mind. When we see around us, this whole universe, we want to find out how it came into being, who runs it, how it is managed, how we are born. These are the questions which agitate our mind, and this has been agitating since times immemorial. Now the human being could not find a satisfactory answer to these questions. They are what I call them unintelligible. And therefore he said there is a divine force which controls all this, and that is the source of religions. The divine force has been defined in various places, in history, in various regions, in various languages. And then these various religions came into existence. Now over time what has happened? That these religions originally came as a part of developing a better society, a better humanity. But the overzealous followers of the religions, they created boundary walls around them, and they created a structure around these religions, and they said this is what is religion. And that structure has overtaken the spirit of the religion in most cases today. The structure is dominating. What I say that the belief, actually now they are promoting blind belief. If you challenge anything written in any of the scriptures, they say you are doing blasphemy. They can even, you know, kill you. That kind of things are happening. The thing which are originally came into being for search of the truth has actually become a hurdle, a biggest hurdle in search of truth. Today we cannot search the truth because the religions are forcing us not to do that at all. And if you do, you will be killed. So today most individuals have become prisoners of such religious power structures. Even before they are born, religious structures take over, deciding their way of life. Human being is not born anymore. No human being is born. What is born is a Hindu, a Christian, a Muslim, a Jew, or something else. No human being is born anymore. This is what the religion have done today. Now the primary purpose of all religions was to guide the humanity to a better path, to a path of compassion, love, but that has been lost. Today, due to prescriptive nature of the most religions and the rituals, religions are often seen as a hurdle in the path of truth, righteousness and virtuous behavior rather than their facilitator. This is what I believe firmly. Religious structures are being used to dictate human life. What an irony! A message of the saint designed to search for truth has actually become an instrument to forbid that very search. This is what we have come to. Now these religious structures have actually become like ideological parties. They are vying for supremacy, that my religion is bigger and better and more powerful, your religion is inferior, therefore you should convert, you should do that, you should do that. This is what is happening. These are like political party playing against each other. And that has been the role of religion today in real life. Now, how do we tackle this problem? This is the biggest issue. We have to educate people the purpose of religion. We also have to tell them that we have been endowed with what you call reasoning and rationality, thinking power. So we must apply our logic to understand what religions are. For example, every religion will tell you that the God is omnipotent, omnipresent. Tell me, does every religion object to that? None of them will object. But this same religion will say that my church is better than your mosque, my temple is better than your church, my synagogue is better than this. Now, why are you confining God to that small little building when he controls the entire universe? He is pervading the entire universe, but we are confining him to a small little hole created by human being. And then we create conflict between the church and the mosque and the temple and the synagogue. This is what we have come to. And I think this must be reasoned out to the public, to the younger generation. The second thing I would like to highlight here, it's a basic principle of life that every diversity originates from unity. If you want to create various designs of clothes, ultimately the cotton behind all the clothes is the same. The fashion designer will come out with variety of fashion designs, only the mind brings out them. Ultimately, if you have millions of ornaments of gold, it's the gold which is the fine basis of all that. So all the diversity comes out of unity. And all these diverse thoughts, religions, everything has come out of one single fact, that there is a divine force controlling this universe. And that force has been manifested by different people in different names, different languages, different forms. And that is what we need to understand. There is nothing superior, nothing inferior, and those people who are dictating you a particular way of life, in fact they are irreligious in my opinion. They do not understand the basic meaning of religion, they do not understand the compassion behind it. And so, I think this is one thing which we must be careful about. The last important point I want to mention is oneness. As I told you, it's very clear today that its universe has become global village. It was much less visible before, but today it is very, very much visible. What happens in Australia or New Zealand affects Trinidad and Tobago, and what happens here affects Japan and Russia on the other side of the world. This oneness of this universe must be understood. It's not only the human oneness, it is also the environmental oneness. We all exist, coexist together. There is no other way but to coexist. And that coexistence should be explained to the people, those who are extremists, those who are terrorists, those who are manifesting all these variety of conflicts in this world. Otherwise, we will be in this infinite race for the enemies find crimes and the state finding means to tackle them. It's not going to end anywhere. So I would like to, given the shortage of time, my paper, I have a few copies, it will be distributed, but I would like to read out the last concluding part of the paper. Now, in a lot of Indian scriptures it has been explained that this whole world is pervaded by God. The God pervades the entire world. Like, you can create in this space a hotel, you demolish this, you can create a toilet, you can create a warehouse, you can create a factory, but the space remains as it is. Same way the God could be manifesting itself in different ways. It is unbroken, it is complete, it remains. In one of the verses in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that Lord pervades ice as Lord pervades the universe as water pervades ice. Ice is nothing but water, and so is the universe nothing but Almighty, the Divine. And that is what we need to bring home. Based on this beautiful scientific explanation, as we consider the entire universe as God, in different names and forms, all violence will come to an end and good will flow and nourish. This will be no conflict based on, there will be no conflict based on nationality, religion, ethnicity or language. There will be no need for security structures and expensive weapons. Love and respect will prevail. Bhagavad Gita says that if we can see self in everybody, and everybody in the self, there is a Sanskrit word called that your own self is the entire world, and you see the entire world in your own self. And that is how then you can do no harm to anybody else. I think this spirit has been said in many scriptures actually. Godliness of the universe also teaches us that we must treat other living being and nature with respect, or else it will lead to our own sufferings. Violence against other beings and nature is akin to violence against one's own self. If we follow this Vedic wisdom and the challenge of climate change, degradation of biodiversity and other man-made ecological disasters will disappear. Harmony between man and nature is an important edge harmony between human race. Let us therefore follow the path of individual freedom, scientific reasoning, critical thinking, unity, oneness, love and tolerance, replacing rigid religious structures based on blind faith and hatred for others. Live and let live should be our motto. All humans are inherently good because each one of us is a particle of God. Let this good come out through introspection and self-contemplation. It should not be dictated by religious institutions. Let thousands of flowers with different colors and fragrances blossom. Each one of us is good and unique in its own way. All of them together provide beauty to this garden called the world. This garden is our home where we take birth, we live and we die. Let us not vitiate or destroy it through the hatred and sectarianism. Those who follow this virtuous path of oneness and diverse manifestations are true followers of all religions. All others are living in ignorance. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I should be Deputy Chairman, since I'm the first after the first.